Well, we're immediately going back to the polls for the seventh time in just over 10 years. I'm surprised Australians weren't getting sick of politics by this point. With Labor finally back in power again, would this election end up being another 1974, crippling them into another wipeout? Or would the Labor government finally achieve some longevity and defy their electoral curse? In 1983, Bob Hawke became only the second Labor Party leader to win an election in over 35 years. Despite Labor's big win, Hawke decided to take a very different approach when it came to his governing. Unlike Whitlam, Hawke would be slow to enact reforms and would for the most part keep Fraser's pre-election agenda intact, instead choosing to reform it slowly over time. Hawke also drastically changed the layout of the Labor cabinet, splitting its members into two tiers, senior and junior, with the national cabinet being made up exclusively of senior members. Hawke would also take a much more formal approach to his cabinet choice by evenly stacking it with members of Labor's multiple factions to prevent any one side gaining too much power. He would also rule with an absolute authority, the likes that had not been seen before in a Labor government. Holding absolute power gave Hawke the ability to effectively push policy. He would also take on a very public role as Prime Minister, frequently appearing on TV to talk to the people. This allowed Hawke to gauge public opinion and push policy that would be popular with Australians. The result of this would see Hawke achieve a whopping 75% approval rating in 1974, the highest for any Prime Minister in Australian history. However, a drawback to this approach was the Americanisation of Australian politics, in which the Prime Minister would overshadow the party when it came to talking about the government's accomplishments. A great example of Hawke's more public approach to governing came on the 27th of September, when Australia would win the American Cup yacht race. For 132 years, the New York Yacht Club, or NYYC, had dominated the competition against any challengers. However, in 1983, under the leadership of Australian businessman Alan Bond, Australia would challenge the NYYC with a special modified boat that almost got it disqualified. Australia would make history by winning the cup. This event made global headlines and was a cause of much celebration in Australia. Hawke would join in on the celebrations, where he would be asked if he thought the day should become a public holiday. Hawke brushed the answer off by simply saying,
"I tell you what, any boss who sacks anyone for not turning up today is a bum."
Meanwhile, on the financial side of things, Hawke, along with his treasurer Paul Keating, would oversee the floating of the Australian dollar, ending the currency's reliance on the gold standard. This was one of the many economic reforms undertaken by Keating, who quickly worked his way up the Labour ranks since entering Parliament in 1969. Along with floating the dollar, Keating would also see the reduction in tariffs, creating a more global economy for Australia. One of Hawke's biggest policy goals would be the Price and Incomes Accord, which sought to bring unions and industry leaders together to sort out worker rights. Previously, unions had become quite the destructive force by frequently striking for what industrial leaders believed were unfair worker terms and wages. Starting in 1983, Hawke would oversee discussions between the two groups, and would create a series of policies which sought to set up guidelines on how unions and industries could resolve disputes without the need for strikes. These discussions would end up taking several years to complete, however in the meantime, Hawke would be forced to immediately head back to the polls for another early election. Due to Fraser's insistence on calling early elections, the House and Senate calendars had again fallen out of sync, and thus to prevent a repeat of the 1960s election mess, Hawke would be forced to call an election for the 1st of December 1984. To date, this is the last time an election has occurred only 1 year after the previous one. The Liberal Party this time would be led by Andrew Peacock, who had the honour of being handpicked by Sir Robert Menzies himself to take over his seat of Kooyong upon his resignation in 1966. As a member of the Liberals' left faction, Peacock had been a supporter of Billy Snedden, and thus did not get on well with the man who took Snedden down, Malcolm Fraser. Throughout Fraser's time in office, Peacock would frequently get into disputes with the PM, even going as far as to challenge him for the role. Eventually, upon Fraser's immediate resignation following the 1983 election, Peacock would beat out John Howard for the role of Liberal Party leader. He would soon be joined by Ian Sinclair, who had taken over as leader from Doug Anthony of the National Party, which had now officially dropped the country title from its name. With the coalition coming off a recent election wipeout, there was little expectation that Peacock could win. However, that would not stop Peacock from running a strong campaign against the young Hawke government. On the 26th of November, Australia would hold its first ever leaders' debate, in which Hawke and Peacock would face off against each other. To a lot of people's surprise, commentators awarded the debating victory to Peacock, claiming that Hawke really underperformed. However, with polls showing a clear win for Labor, most pundits didn't think much of this debate. The election would also see a large increase to both the House and Senate seats, to bring the House up to 148 seats and the Senate up to its current 76 seats. This would be the largest increase to the seat count since the 1949 election. And the winner was Bob Hawke and Labour with 82 seats, a gain of 7. However, this gain was due to an increase in the seat count, and Labour would actually lose their total percent of the seats, now holding 55%, down from 60. This was also seen in Labour's two-party preferred result, which had dropped by 1.46%, down to 51.77. These results came as a shock to most pundits who had predicted Labour would have done better. Hawke blamed the underperforming results on voters confused with changes done to the Senate ballots, which he believed led some to incorrectly fill up voting tickets, resulting in their votes being invalidated. Another issue believed to have affected Labour's results was the Coombe affair. In 1983, David Coombe, a Labour Party secretary, was accused by ASIO of being a security risk due to his relationship with Soviet diplomat Valery Ivanov. Foreign Minister Bill Hayden, under Hawke's orders, would immediately expel Ivanov, while Coombe would be denied access to the government despite being a lobbyist. A royal commission would later exonerate Coombe of any wrongdoing, but the damage had been done, and a bitter Coombe would leave Australia and move to Canada, claiming that he was only trying to set up a trade deal. To some voters, Hawke had acted too quickly in favour of ASIO, an organisation despised by most Labour supporters. Just see the 1954 election for why. Meanwhile, Peacock, despite not winning, had picked up 16 seats to hold 66. Peacock seemed pretty optimistic that these results meant good things for the coalition's chances in the next election, proclaiming,
"The resurgence was as I felt it throughout the nation, and if I can do that in 50 days, just think of what I'll do in the next 1,000. Thank you all very much."
And with that, he would optimistically go into the new parliament, confident that in 3 years' time, he would be the new prime minister. Come back next time for the election of 1987.